Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. Take a look at where today's field trip has brought us, Saguaro National Park. To find Saguaro National Park, we had to travel to the American Southwest, specifically to the state of Arizona, which is located in a region known as the Sonoran Desert. As we've been exploring some of the park this morning, Mia was especially intrigued by the giant cacti everywhere. They are definitely very different from the types of plants we've seen in other biomes. Why do you think that is? What environmental factors here are likely to lead to plants such as giant cacti? What types of adaptations do you think plants and animals here will need to survive in these conditions? Pause the video and make some predictions. The landscape here is beautiful, but I'm starting to think that coming to the desert in the middle of summer was a bad idea. It's over 100 degrees and not a cloud in sight. I'm going to have to find some shade soon. Whew. Some of my friends camped out here last night and said it was actually cool enough that they wished they brought heavier jackets. I can't even imagine wanting a jacket in this place at all. How could it have been so much colder here last night? Well, one hint as to why we see such a difference between day and night temperatures in a desert has to do with precipitation, or the lack of it. One of the park rangers told me this morning that they haven't had a single drop of rain in over 2 weeks, and apparently, this is a common occurrence here. Do you remember learning about the world's climate zones in our atmosphere unit? What type of climate would a desert have? Dry. You can see on the map that a large part of the western United States is in this zone as well, but it doesn't get much drier than right here in Saguaro National Park. With very little moisture in the air, the atmosphere of a desert doesn't hold in a lot of heat once the sun goes down at night, which means it can get much colder than you might expect. But the dry climate also means less cloud cover to provide shade, so temperatures during the day can skyrocket. As you might guess, with such a dry atmosphere, there aren't a lot of bodies of water in the Sonoran Desert. We learned in the hydrosphere unit that high temperatures tend to drive a faster water cycle. And it certainly gets hot during the day here. But heat can only cause evaporation if there's water on the ground to evaporate. And there's very little of that in this desert. So even though it's hot, there's only a minimal amount of water cycle activity in most deserts, but the desert's hydrosphere isn't completely empty. Take a look at the nearby Santa Cruz River. This is an example of an ephemeral river, which only flows when there has been enough rainfall in the area. Even though it's small and intermittent, its impact on life here can be easily seen on a map. Can you spot the river on the Sonoran landscape? I'll give you a hint. You can't actually see the river, but you can see the vegetation it supports. A small strip of green land in a desert often signifies the presence of a river or other body of water. Of course, deserts do get rain sometimes, just not very often. How do you think the landscape reacts to rain? It often leads to sudden and dramatic flash floods. To understand why that is, we'll need to look at another sphere, the geosphere. How do you think we could describe the geosphere here in the Sonoran Desert? We definitely don't see much in the way of soil. In fact, the terrain is almost all rocky and sandy. This is why floods can happen during the infrequent rains. There's nothing to soak up the water as it falls. So it just runs over the landscape. But the soft, sandy surface is a welcome feature for small animals that like to burrow into it, making it an easy way for them to get underground and escape the heat. Now that we've seen the abiotic factors at work here in the Sonoran Desert of Arizona, let's see what type of biotic factors we can find. I asked Mia to take a tour through the national park this morning and record some of the most interesting life she found. Let's see what she came up with. The most obvious plant life here in Saguaro National Park is the very cactus that the park was named after, and Mia's favorite, the giant saguaro cactus. Its accordion-like structure allows it to store large amounts of water, so when it does rain, it can hold onto this water to see it through the inevitable dry spells. And instead of leaves, these cacti have spines. Can you think of a reason why spines would be advantageous in a dry climate? They have less surface area, so less water evaporates out of them. But these majestic cacti aren't the only unique plant life around. Mia noticed that nestled around the cacti, you will often find creosote bushes with their small yellow flowers. These hardy plants grow exceptionally deep roots to access groundwater reserves and have a waxy coating on their leaves to prevent evaporation. Thanks to the creosote bushes, we've attracted some wildlife. Their seeds are a staple for the many ground squirrels that inhabit the Sonoran Desert. I think Mia must have befriended a few of these cuties while she was exploring. What other animals do you think Mia found out here? Mia says that some of her favorites were the Gila monsters, though they can be hard to find during the day because they retreat to underground burrows to avoid the sweltering midday heat. Did you know that Gila monsters have unusually efficient kidneys and can even reabsorb water from their urine when necessary? Definitely seems like a great adaptation to have out here. And the Gila monsters aren't the only ones that have it. The desert tortoise uses a similar physiology to conserve water and is especially good at pulling water out of the food it consumes so that it is less dependent on finding freestanding water sources. And when the tortoise needs to get out of the sun, it simply digs itself a hole and climbs in. Mia made one more friend to introduce us to, the gambel's quail. These birds are only active in the early morning and evening, allowing them to avoid the hottest part of the day as they forage for food. And they are particularly adapted to survive on food sources such as seeds and insects that are available even during the desert's driest months. What did you notice about all of the plants and animals that Mia found? What do their adaptations have in common? Pause the video for a moment and see if you can make the connection. All of the plants and animals in the Sonoran Desert and other deserts across the world are adapted to harsh conditions brought on by a lack of abundant water sources and extreme heat. Finding ways to solve these challenges means that life can find a way, even here, in what feels like a rather inhospitable biome. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how environmental factors such as high temperatures and a lack of water influenced the life found in the Sonoran Desert of Arizona. Even though many hardy creatures have learned to survive out here, the ecosystem certainly has its share of challenges. Today, many of these challenges are heightened by human activity. As our cities expand, the demand for limited water resources further strains this already parched ecosystem, and fragile habitats are often disrupted as human infrastructure is built. Finding ways to balance both our needs and the needs of other species living here will be the key to a sustainable future in the Sonoran Desert. In the lesson activities, you'll take a closer look at how humans have impacted the Sonoran Desert and what we can do to lessen that impact. Until next time, remember, the biosphere is all around us, so keep diving into this web of life and exploring its wonders. Stay curious, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.